thought that was beautiful. I love that song. I love that hymn, and I love the way you did that, Ellen. Thank you for being here. Let's see. Today is May 9th. It's the last Sunday of... Is there anything else going on today? Oh, yes, it's Mother's Day. And in just a moment here, Deborah, where are you? You've been moving all around, and I can't... You're mercurial. I cannot keep up with you. I'm going to... Deborah is the chair of our worship ministry, and you're going to come up and make sure that we give out something for the mothers today, right? You want to come on up? Anyway, welcome for being here, and we're glad you're here today, and we hope today is a good time of worship. Deborah, take it away.
Okay. We have a special little present for all of the ladies in the worship service today. I've been a teacher for 30-some-odd years, and I don't want y'all to do the math on that, but I'm firmly convinced that parenthood, whether it's moms or dads, is a sacred trust. God is entrusting us with his very precious gifts of children. And some people take that more seriously than others. And it makes me sad as a teacher when I see children that don't get the love and care that they need at home. And I know all of my teacher buddies here see that all the time. So we have purchased for you a special little bookmark. And on that bookmark, ladies, if y'all wouldn't mind, y'all can go ahead and start passing those out. My beautiful little friends are going to pass these out to you guys. It's the John 3:16 verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And I always think of God as a parent. And if he could give up his son for me, what a sacrifice. What a sacrifice. Because I know I couldn't give my daughter up for all of you. I love you, but not that much. Right? And so I like this verse. I want all the moms here to remember this and think about it as they make their mother's journey, wherever you are on that journey. If you've got little ones, babies, grown-ups, because they're all our babies always, right? And always remember how God has entrusted you with this very, very precious gift. We love you all. And thank you, moms, for everything that you do.
Our call to worship today is adapted from Matthew chapter 23. So I would call you to worship today, this day on which we celebrate the women in our lives, with the words of Jesus to his difficult children. When he said, "How often have I desired to gather you children together as a mother hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing." May our time together today be a time of gathering, a time of safety, and a time of willingness to be with our Lord. May we worship.
Faith will be for the world confessed. Thy name.
Pray with me, please. Holy God of all wisdom, Mother of love beyond our knowing, cradle us, your loving children, in your comforting bosom. Hold us close in your loving care. Shelter us securely in stormy weather. Whisper words of assurance to us when we are close to stumbling, and love us tenderly. Forever and ever and always, amen, blessed be, let it be so. And now let us pray together the prayer our Savior Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may be seated. I want to read a portion of scripture from the New Testament book of Hebrews. And just to put all this in context, this is a portion of a whole chapter that if you haven't already read it before, you should read the whole thing in entirety. We're taking a slice of it. This is the roll call of saints. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he'd been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he too was old and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises. But from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear that they're seeking a homeland. If they'd been thinking of the land they'd left, they would have had an opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. Increasingly, over the years, I dig out the church's roll book to find the name of a long-ago member. It helps me write a eulogy to connect a name to a time, a season of the year, to take note of the people who joined with them, the cohort of faith. When I find the name, I trace it back to the church's minister. He joined during Chester Crow's days. She joined when Wilbur Mix was minister. Back in the 40s or 50s or 60s, I remember the time, I imagine the season, and a story begins to come alive in my mind's eye. I think historical context says as much about a person's life as any of the details. Transfer of membership, baptism, Easter Sunday, some other day of the year. I wonder what the occasion was. Sometimes I look and I can't find a name. Not easily. Takes me longer than I think it should. And over the years, I figured out why. I know, for instance, that if I want to find when Judy Garrett joined, I don't look for her name. I scan the roll book for Mrs. Dale Garrett. For as far back as the roll book was written down, it almost always reads like this, him in reference to her. There's no disrespect intended. It was the custom back then. When we spoke about her, we figured out how or if she was related to him. And still I blush. It embarrasses me a little bit how easily we have dropped her name to talk about him. I know it's no disrespect, but I really don't like to minimize her life, her person, her namesake to talk about him. It's a generational thing, of course, but it still strikes me. A few years ago, on the occasion of my graduation from Austin Seminary, the school sent me a letter of congratulations. How the letter was addressed? Reverend Dr. and Mrs. Daniel C. Jones. All those words, and yet something seemed to be missing. They took a picture of me parading around in my rented robe. But I knew that after years of having spent achieving that accomplishment, I would not have been a doctor unless she had agreed to be my missus. You know, you ask her, she'll tell you the rest of the story, those insufferably long years in the back room with a couple of tables stretched out with piles of papers, or 2 weeks there while she stayed here. She gave me her blessing. And I wish somebody would kindly just say her name. Reverend Dr. and Mrs. Dan Jones. I remember poring over all my childhood recollections the late night, early morning before my mother's funeral. And I got a little legal pad and I began to jot down her accomplishments, a teaching degree later in life, teaching appointments here, there, her mannerisms, her wit, her sharp intellect, and the way she would give you that look. Now, but finally, I thought of her as a young woman with dreams and aspirations of her own, bundling up three kids in the dead of winter in the back of the family car so that we could travel 800 miles, maybe more, from here to there, riding shotgun in the front seat with my dad so that he could answer his call to ministry. Was it ever really only his call? He went to seminary while she worked an assortment of jobs, and we lived in this house and that house. She told me, insisted that it was true, that they were elated to get a parsonage with a swamp cooler. But I don't know if that was true. She sat in celebration when he got his credentials. She packed up and came too each time he received another call. As I say, she wanted this, the life she chose, but still I can't shake the image of the story of the night. She says, we came to a stop at a railroad crossing in the pitch black of an Oklahoma night, January. And she and he looked at each other and thought, what in God's name have we done bringing our children here? In some ways, her call was his call. They were always intertwined like this. Now, the book of Genesis picks up his story towards the end of chapter 11. For reasons we don't quite know, his dad, Terah, decided to move the family from Ur to Canaan. Only they never made it that far. They stopped along the way, and they decided to make a home in Haran. It's only after Terah dies that God calls him, tells him to take his family, her included, and all the things that they had accumulated to continue the journey to Canaan. God had plans for him and her and their family. The writer of Genesis says they go, Abraham and his brother and their wives and their children. You know, I read the story and I wish I could have been a fly on the wall to hear the discussion, not just the words, but the tone of voice. Abraham's adamance, giving her instruction. Well, Sarah, God told me to do this. And they needed to pack up and go from here. I wonder what she said about all this. Haran represented civilization and culture. Canaan was nothing. It was wilderness. We know Abraham and his wife as some of the first God-fearers. But in the beginning, They didn't have the kind of religion we talk about in this church. They weren't Jews. They weren't like us. They were Persians from modern-day Iraq. Scripture says he went as God told him. And then the writer adds, he took his wife, Sarah. Still no mention that she had any interest in going. In the beginning, she's simply following along her husband's vision. Sadly, the only thing that Genesis makes clear is that Sarah had a problem. She was childless. She was beautiful. Abraham admits that, but she was 65 years old, and she still had not blessed him with a son. By the only measure that we're given, she was a failure. Scripture also makes clear that she was jealous of her husband's maid Hagar, and that when the angels of the Lord visited them at Mamre with news of birth to come, she laughed in the face of God. And the rest of the story about him. Even when the New Testament mentions her, it's to talk about her role in accomplishing his vision. Paul in Romans 4 says her prolonged barrenness is evidence of his faith. 1 Peter 3:6, her submission to him is cited as an example of godly adornment. Even this morning's passage, specifically verse 11, here in what's known as the roll call of saints, finally, we think, Sarah is going to get her rightful due. And the litany begins to build early. We think it's going to happen. By faith, Abel offered. By faith, Enoch was taken. By faith, Noah respected. By faith, Abraham obeyed. And finally, by faith, Sarah. No. There's a question in the verse about her faith. Is it about his faith or her faith? And it depends. And I'm not going to bore you with mind-numbing talk of textual variants. I could say that with all the manuscripts from which the New Testament is written, there are thousands of variants, only to say there's a difficult interpretive issue in this morning's text. Some say Abraham is the subject of the faith. Others say Sarah is. Some say the passage declares that by faith Sarah conceived. And others say by faith Abraham, despite Sarah's barrenness, was able to procreate. And from this point, Sarah's moment of glory fades into literary digression. The long and short, even in Hebrew, centuries after Sarah was laid to rest in a family cave in Hebron at the ripe age of 129, even after all of this, there is still a debate as to who gets the credit for having kept the faith in God's vision. In Hebrews, even Rahab, the prostitute of Jericho, gets her due. But nobody simply says that Sarah came to her own faith and understanding about God's vision, which she did, and thank God for this. In his commentary on Hebrews, the late American Orthodox Bishop Dimitri Royster says, what I wish that Scripture would say without dueling textual variants. Her faith in God's promise, even though it was the result of later reflection, was more consistent with her spiritual state and earns her a place in the list of Old Testament faithful. Period. Which is why I am declaring this Mother's Day St. Sarah Day. And I want all the women who've been patient with their men and been vastly underestimated, who have been cast aside and misunderstood, who seriously tried to understand the vision of God that they've claimed to see, who've traveled across the country with them, squinting their eyes to try to see what he sees, and have forgiven them when they have doubted their own vision, I want you to stand up and be counted today on this St. Sarah Day. I hereby declare that there will be no asterisk put beside your name, no footnote to explain some insufferable textual variant to try to put question of what you've done with your own life simply by faith, even Sarah herself, by her faith. Now, about that late night pondering on the night before my mother's funeral, the more I thought about it, thought about her life, the more deeply grateful I was for the strength that she had to support my dad so that he could spend his life serving God in the church. Thank you, Mother. You're among the great cloud of witnesses. Take your rightful place among the great cloud, the roll call of saints. You're among them. And thank you all the moms in the congregation today. We sometimes forget to remember the critical part that you play in the unfolding of God's salvation drama. Abraham went, but so did Sarah. Her journey to promise counts.
It's interesting, troublesome perhaps, but still interesting, that practically none of the classic paintings of the Last Supper have a woman in the frame. Do you really think men prepared all that food? Do you think the men poured the wine? Do you think the men cleaned up afterward? No, we're told they went to the garden and sang hymns and then went to sleep. We have to imagine that there were some women at the table, or at least in the room. Mary Magdalene, mother of James, Salome, and perhaps even Jesus' own mother. The Last Supper would surely not have happened had it not been for the women in the room. Consider this, if you will, as we gather at the table today. Consider the women in your life who have prepared you for this time. Consider the women of this congregation who serve so steadfastly. Consider the very image mentioned above of Jesus as a mother hen gathering her chicks beneath her wings. In that knowledge and that assurance, come, eat and drink, and celebrate. Let us pray. O God, our faithful Father and loving Mother, be with us, we pray, as we share in this feast set before us today. Bless this bread we break. Bless this cup poured out. Bless us, your children, as we dedicate ourselves as your disciples. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. On that last night, Jesus, with the full room of men and women, took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is to be broken for you. Do this and remember me." Also, after supper, he took the cup, and after blessing it, he shared it with his disciples and all gathered there, saying, "This cup is the blood of the new covenant, which is to be poured out for you. Each time you drink it, remember me." For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you remember the Lord's death until he comes. Thank you.
In the past week's study of the life of Sarah and Abraham, one clear insight has come to me. Faith counts, but the blessing of God can't come to any of us than by God's mercy. And as much as I love to remember their story, the Bible pictures of them is utterly an ordinary one. Sarah laughs and Abraham fiddles. And yet, God's promise manages somehow to unfold through them, most of the time, despite them. Let their story be a lesson about our stories. You know, be as good as you could possibly be. Give generously, not because you must, but because you can. Do the best to go where God leads you. But at the end of the day, recognize your life is all grace. You and I can't be as good as half the resolutions that we make. And remember, the small stuff really does matter. Fred Craddock used to tell this story about how, you know, we go through life thinking we're going to give away our life and faith to God in big dramatic moments. He said, but the truth is we're called to give it away consistently one quarter at a time. Do that. And today, remember the saints. They turned their lives in the direction of God's will. Make that your guiding vision as we stand to sing our closing hymn. Seated while I give you the benediction, and I want to thank you for being here, and I hope the rest of the day is a good one. And if you're going to be outside, I really hope it doesn't rain on you. But anyway, it's been a good day. Ellen, I've loved Judy. I've loved the music today. It's just been beautiful. I've forgotten how much I like that Softly and Tenderly song. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Mm-hmm.